Get to this series, King Saul. He's one of the characters in the Bible that just squandered his potential. He was the first king of 43 kings of Israel and Judah that the people wanted. And from the very beginning, they wanted something that they should not. They begged God for something they shouldn't have had. And this is the case here. 43 kings, 31 of them, it's recorded about them at the end of their little caption in the Bible. It says they did evil in the sight of the Lord. 31 of the 43. Only 7 have the caption that says they did right in the sight of the Lord. And then there was 5 that have mixed reviews. And so we see that King Saul, he's the first one to do evil in the sight of the Lord. He completely squandered his potential. He is the classic example in Scripture for this. And he had everything on the outward appearance that you would need for success, that we think that we need for success. He was great looking. He was tall. He was handsome. He was, strong but he did not, King Saul did not deal with the issues of his heart. He did not deal with his struggles, his many struggles. And I love these Old Testament narratives. If you have not read 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel, I encourage you to sit down this week and read through this. Just some amazing stories, true stories of how God worked in people's lives, how people failed God and still God was faithful to them. And so we see in this 1 Samuel chapter, in these 1 Samuel chapters, that Saul had a lot of issues. He had a lot going against him. He was insecure, right? If he was in regen, if you don't know what regen, it's our recovery ministry, and we have a list of 117 things that people struggle with. And Saul would have had a lot of marks on his. He would have highlighted a lot of those struggles, and so he had insecurity. He suffered from jealousy. He loved attention and praise. He loved the praise of man more than the approval of God. He was angry sometimes, and he had a lot of independence from God. He was prideful. He lacked true accountability. He trivialized his sin. He blame shifted. He was disobedient, rebellious. He also had the fear of failure. And there's many more that we could probably dig out of these passages, but King Saul's failure was a faith issue. He was unfaithful because he did not deal with his weaknesses. However, there was this big, colossal failure of faith corporately in the nation of Israel from the very beginning. Before King Saul failed, the nation failed from their desires to have a king. So let's go to 1 Samuel chapter 8, and let's look at this corporate failure. It says, when Samuel became old, he made his sons judges over Israel. The name of his firstborn was Joel, and the name of his second Abijah. They were judges in Beersheba, yet his sons did not walk in his ways, but turned aside after gain. They took bribes and perverted justice. They were just some bad dudes. They were only looking after themselves, very selfish. And then all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah and said to them, "Behold, you are old." They didn't have a lot of tact either. "You are old, and your sons do not walk in your ways. They appoint for us a king, or appoint for us now a king to judge us like all the nations." But the thing displeased Samuel, and they said, "Give us a king to judge us." And Samuel prayed to the Lord, and the Lord said to Samuel, "Obey the voice of the people in all that they say to you. For they have not rejected you, but they have rejected me from before king, being king over you. According to all the deeds that they have done from the day I brought them out of Egypt, even to this day, forsaking me and serving other gods, so they are also doing to you. Now then, obey their voice only. You shall solemnly warn them and show them the ways of the king who shall reign over them." Okay, so I just have 2 points for us this morning, and they're formed in a question that we need to answer, both corporately and individually. And the first one is do we have corporate areas that we are unfaithful? We go to verses 4 and 5 in this passage, and it says, "And all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah and said to him, 'Behold, you are old, and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now appoint for us a king to judge us like all the nations.'" There, before Saul failed in and was unfaithful, the nation as a whole was unfaithful. It says here that the elders got together. I still don't completely wrap my mind around that leadership of elders in this context. I'm not sure we can really know that for sure, but was it a group of men that was appointed, or was it just the older gentleman that had some influence? But I believe it was appointed positions that these men were there to help guide Samuel. So they make this decision, and they assessed the situation that they had at hand. Samuel was getting older, and the people that were supposed to take his place, his sons, were doing evil things. And so he said, they made a request that was unfaithful. They made an unfaithful request. Israel had already had a king. It was God. That was their leader. That was their king. They were to look to him constantly for guidance, and they didn't need a king, but it says here that they wanted to be like everybody else. Their decision, their desire to have a human king was a faithless decision. And so I want to talk about faith, and I need a volunteer for this. And so let's do this right there. So I have this thing here, and I'm gonna ask somebody to volunteer and to do something that will take a little bit of faith. You will? He doesn't even know what it is. And all right, have a seat. This is just water, right? And this is just a regular Ziploc. It's not Ziploc. It's actually it's a knockoff. It's not the real Ziploc. All right. But it's some water here, and I got some pencils. And do you believe that I can put a pencil through this and it not leak out on you? You do? Are you sure? All right, let's take a poll. Who believes I can put a pencil straight through this water and not get in it? Who believes that? Okay, who believes that I can't? Based on everybody here, you might need this.
That
You might need that. Do you think you need it?
No.
Okay. All right. You ready?
I'm ready.
All right. Sure?
Mm-hmm. Just don't let me.
Do you trust me?
I trust you.
Okay. All right. You still trust me? Look.
Yeah, but you didn't take it out.
No, I don't understand that.
If you take it out, the water shouldn't come out.
Oh yeah, I didn't say that I would take it out. I just said that I could put it through.
Okay.
Do you think I could do another one?
Yes.
Okay. Let's see. You sure?
Yes.
That takes some faith. Thank you. And you didn't even need the towel.
I didn't think I would.
Can you take this with you?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you. So, we need faith to be faithful. Unfaithfulness is not trusting God in a lot of things. So, there's... The Greek words, there's two Greek words in the New Testament that are often translated somehow to mean unfaithfulness. And one is porneia, which is unfaithfulness. It's like adultery. It's fornication and those things. It's a word that which we get our English word pornography from. And the other one is related to the word faith. Taking faith and making it negative where it's void of faith. So unfaithfulness can be a way that we really limit God's potential in our lives. And we see this with corporately as a nation. They made this unfaithful request and then they were deceptive about their reasoning. And they took their situation and they exploited for their own desires and said, man, you're getting way too old and your sons are not doing what they're supposed to. And they exploited that rather than trusting in God that God would correct it. God could have handled that situation, but they were deceptive. And so they tweaked it so that it would work to their advantage. And how often do we do that in our lives? And we make requests of God that are faithless when we should asking for big things that God would do, like a bridge in Chad to help bridge not only their safety, but that they would understand the gospel and it would be a tool that would gain the respect of those sharing the gospel. Big requests, not deceptive requests that feed our own fleshly desires. They also rejected their unique identity for them that God had for them. God called them out among all the people. The Hebrew people were the chosen nation. They were blessed to be a blessing. They were to take that. They had a personal relationship with God. They had the presence of God, and they were to help other nations see how blessed they were so that they too would want to be blessed by that, and they wanted to be like other nations. They were motivated. Their motivation in doing this sin was a direct violation of their God-given, unique identity. And we have an identity in Christ that a lot of times that we either forget about or we don't understand, and we aren't the people that we should be because of We deny our identity. And so corporately, we have this identity in our community. We have this identity right now because of this great event and the events that we've done in the past, that our church loves our community, and we do a lot. Even though people say that, hey, Liberty Church, they do a lot for their community. And we want to continually do better and better at that. And that God would use us as a bridge to share the gospel with our community. And in order for us to do that, we need to embrace our identity. And I think that we're starting to see that in some ways. Like, we know that we need a Spanish translation of our services and other services that we do. We need that, and we're going to build that. And that's part of our identity. For whatever reason, God has made us very multicultural. And we want the gospel to be heard in the language that people can understand. And if that means we translate several different languages, then that's what we do. We want to plant churches. We want to plant churches because planting churches, new churches, they take on the identity of being outwardly focused and inviting people to church and sharing the gospel openly with everyone. And because they are small and they want to grow, we want to plant churches. I think the first church that we're going to plant is within this church, is a Spanish church, Spanish-speaking church. And we see that there is a need for this. So we need to make sure we don't reject our unique identity corporately. And then they had divided hearts between God and the world. They wanted to be like the other people. And they wanted to serve themselves. They wanted what they wanted rather than what God wanted. He was their king. They wanted something else. They had divided hearts. They had this history of serving other gods. Before this, there was judge after judge that God had to raise up in order to deliver them from another nation that was coming down on them. And so divided hearts will cause us to squander our unique plan that God has us, our potential. Matthew 6:24 says, "No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, and he will be devoted to the one and despise the other." You cannot serve God and money. We have to make sure our hearts are undivided and solely devoted to Jesus. Just like Israel had a choice to be faithful to God, we have a choice today as a church corporately to trust Him in this time. I mean, the pandemic is a great example of us trusting God corporately. As soon as we were mandated that we could not have services more than 10, we shut down. And I believe that was a faithful thing to do. But as soon as we were able to not, we then developed a team in order for us to be safe and to come in here according to the mandates of the state. And when most churches and some churches haven't even opened up yet. And so we are trying very hard corporately not to have divided hearts. So we want to deepen our commitment to get the gospel to the ends of the earth, and that's why we partner with missionaries that are called, like the Hoyts and like so many others, that are called to a specific place, a unique identity in the world. And that they would accomplish what they need to do. And they need us, and we need them. It's a partnership. We want to deepen that. Mark 16, 15, go into the world and proclaim the gospel to a whole creation. That's what we want to do. We'll continue to develop deeper and deeper relationships with our partner missionaries and grow that. And we also have this deep and growing commitment to our community. And I've already talked some about this, but Jesus has promised us that we will have the power in his presence of the Holy Spirit when we minister to our Jerusalem. Acts 1:8 says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. We want to continue to push. In order for us to continue to push, we need to make faithful decisions corporately. We need to make sure that we're doing what he has called us to do. And he's called us to tithe. He's called us to give to faith missions. He's called us to be generous. And we have many, many generous people in this church. But corporately, are we as generous as that we can be? I don't look at names of those that give. I've just chosen as a pastor. I would not want to be influenced by who gives more than somebody else or doesn't someone that doesn't give at all. I don't want to be influenced by that knowledge. I do know some of our biggest givers because we congratulate them, we encourage them, and we want to tell them that we're grateful for them. But I don't know the dollar amounts of anybody here that gives, and I choose to do that so I'm not influenced by it. But I do know this: there's about 40 family units that give regularly to our offerings. And that's awesome. Giving is great. We should want to give. We've been given a lot. We've been blessed with salvation. We should want to make sure that we're giving so that other people can receive the same. However, there are only about 50% of that actually tithe, that we don't understand what everybody makes, but we can kind of guess that maybe that person is tithing or that family is tithing or not. And so just strict number, because I don't know whose names, about 50% of the people that give actually tithe. I mean, and tithing is simple. It's 10%. We have about 50 people of that. I don't know what that is of our whole population, but it's probably about 25% maybe or less that are actually trusting God. So you get 100% and you're saying, you know what, I'm going to take the 10% and I'm going to give that to God first, and I'm better off, they're trusting that I'm better off with 90% than 100%. Now only God can do that. He does that all the time when we trust him, when we're faithful to him. And I can remember when I first started giving and tithing and trusting God with that 90%. It was tough. It was really hard. I was a new believer and I heard that message. But you know what? When I finally was faithful to it, I understood that I was so much better off with less than more. And so, corporately, we need to do better in this area of tithing and giving. There's 17 family units that give specifically to missions. And so, if you're not giving to missions, man, it's our corporate goal. It's our corporate mission as a church to reach the ends of the earth. It's God has mandated that up to us, and we need to help our partner missionaries get there and do what they need to do and have everything that they need to share the gospel with the people group, the unique people group that God has called them to. All right, so first, being faithful begins corporately. Israel failed corporately, and they also failed individually. And well, let's look at Saul. And my second point is formed in a question that we need to answer. Do I have individual areas that I am unfaithful? We all need to answer that question. The quick answer to that is yes. We all have some area at some time, if not multiple, that we're not faithful in. We need to be faithful individually. We need to, it's okay to not be okay, but it's not okay to stay there. This is a safe place. You can come as you are. We highly believe that we can be fully known and fully loved. In fact, we're discovering in Regen, the more we know one another, the more we love one another. It's okay to not be okay, but it's not okay to stay there. We don't want you to stay there. And it's not a selfish thing. It's basically, if I've been blessed with understanding of God's faithfulness to me, and when I respond to that in faithfulness to Him, there's a quality of life that just God puts on you. Yeah, some things might get a little sticky, and things might get rough in other areas, but there's a peace, there's a joy that can't be replaced by unfaithfulness. Our faithfulness matters. And here, we know that we need a lot of grace, and Saul needed a lot of grace. And did he need a lot of grace? Because he had a lot of habits and hang-ups that he didn't deal with. And the story that we're going to look at here in chapter 13 is about 2 years into his kingship. And so let's go to verse 5 in chapter 13 and start reading the story. It says, "And the Philistines mustered a fight with Israel, 30,000 chariots and 6,000 horsemen and troops like the sand of the seashore in multitude." So first of all, this is like one of the big tests, the huge test that Israel would face as and have their king. They wanted a king because they wanted to be like all the other nations, that they would be judged and they would have so that they could lead their armies into battle. Well, this is a battle, but look at the army that's assembled against them. That number, 30,000, is probably 3,000 chariots, but still, it's astronomical. It's much larger. Israel did not have that type of weaponry. They had horsemen, 6,000 horsemen, and they had a number of troops on foot that is described as when you go to a beach, how many grains of sand do you see? It was an astronomical ask for this army to go against what they were facing, the Philistines. And so I can kind of understand the response that Saul has here. It says they came up and encamped at Michmash and to the east of Beth Haven. When the men of Israel saw that they were in trouble, where the people were hard pressed, the people hid themselves in caves and in holes and in rocks and in tombs and in cisterns. And some Hebrews crossed the fords of the Jordan, the land of Gad and Gilead. It's about 15 miles away. They ran, and Saul was still in Gilgal, and all the people followed him trembling. They were scared. And it was Saul's command that he was supposed to go. Samuel had told them, go. And I will be there in 7 days. Get prepared. Get your army prepared. Strengthen yourselves. But in 7 days, I'll be there. I'll make the sacrifice. And it says he waited 7 days in a time appointed by Samuel. But Samuel did not come to Gilgal, and the people were scattered from him. So it was a dire thing that he was facing. Saul was facing. His army was leaving him. So Saul said, bring the burnt offering here to me and the peace offering. And he offered the burnt offering. This was not his lane. You know, in ministry, we need to learn to stay in our lanes. This was not his lane. This was Samuel's lane. And he saw this situation and decided to take it upon himself. The normal routine would be that the priest, in this case, the judge, Samuel, would come and offer this offering, this sacrifice, and would find out if God's favor was upon them. And if the favor was upon them, it didn't matter the lopsided, the army's lopsidedness of what they saw in the Philistines. It didn't matter because God was on their side. How great is our God? And that's what they would find out in this process. They offered a sacrifice. So Saul, seeing the situation, he does it himself. He gets in Samuel's lane and he does it himself. Saul had this pressure that I think most leaders understand. When you see something that's not going your way, you want to take control of it and try to manipulate the situation. I don't know. Have you ever manipulated another person because you thought that you needed to take control? I mean, there's a lot of application in our lives. Saul took this into his own hand. We see that it says in verse 10, and as soon as they had finished offering the burnt offering, behold, Samuel came. And Saul went out to meet him and greet him. And Samuel said, what have you done? Now, have you ever watched somebody make a mistake? Like maybe it was a child, or maybe it was a friend. And what's your first response? What did you do? What have you done? I can remember as a kid, I was about 8 or so. I had an older foster brother at the time. He was living with us for a couple years, and he was a teenager. And you know, we lived on a farm, and my dad had told him to spread fertilizer on this one field, and he worked a full-time job. My dad worked a full-time job, and he came home from work, and he saw the wagon that had the fertilizer on it, and he saw how much was left, and he knew that that meant that there was way too much, like twice as much fertilizer was spread on that field. He knew that he needed... He had ordered just enough fertilizer to fertilize all the fields that we were going to plant in that spring, and he knew that most of it was gone. And his first response was, "What have you done?" And he said a lot of other things, a lot of other words that I probably hadn't heard up to that point in my life, but that's kind of like the situation. Samuel's in here. What have you done, Saul? This was a bad thing. And so Saul had to explain himself. And Saul said, when I saw that the people were scattered from me and that you did not come within the days appointed. So he blame shifting. He says, you didn't come when the day was appointed and that the Philistines had mustered in Michmash. I said, now the Philistines will come down against me at Gilgal, and I have not sought the favor of the Lord. So I forced myself and offered the burnt offering. I had to. You forced me. I didn't want to do it, but you forced me since you weren't here. And so King Saul feared the approval of man. He feared man more than he desired the approval of God. And that can happen, easily happen in our lives. And it happens maybe that we don't necessarily feel like we're capable of serving Christ in the church and doing. We think less of ourselves, or we think that there's so many other people that are so more, much more gifted in certain areas, and they certainly don't need me. And it's feeding into our fear of man and our rather than the approval of God and so many other things, insecurity. There was this time that Saul was unfaithful, that his fear led him to be unfaithful. And we go back to chapter 10 because there was another time that we see that Saul was fearful. And you go to Samuel chapter 10, verse 1. Now, this was during the time when Saul was sent out to find his father's donkeys, and they were missing. And so he said, go find these donkeys. And so he went out, and he couldn't find them. And he'd been traveling all over the countryside for days, couldn't find them. Samuel was told by God that go ahead, give them a king, and this king is Saul. If you go here, you can find him. He goes and he finds Saul, and he tells him, hey, God is going to make you the king. And here it is. It says in verse 1, it says, and Samuel took a flask of oil and poured it on his head and kissed him and said, has not the Lord anointed you to be the prince over his people Israel? And you shall reign over the people of the Lord, and you will save them from the land, from the hand of the surrounding enemies. And this shall be the sign to you that the Lord has anointed you to be the prince over his heritage. And so he said, okay, I'm anointing you as king. And he actually told him, he said, hey, these things are going to happen in the next couple of days, and it's going to be a sign to you that what I'm telling you is true. And sure enough, those things happen. So then there was I don't know what the time period is between that anointing and there was a public coronation where Saul would be crowned king. And this is amazing. I don't know how many times I've read this and I've never seen this. And it says, then Samuel, verse 20, and Samuel brought all the tribes of Israel near, and the tribe of Benjamin was taken by lot. So they did this process of casting lots to decide what the Lord wanted them to do. And so they did this, and it decided that the king was going to come from Benjamin, and then the tribe of Benjamin. And then they narrowed it down even further. In verse 21, he brought the tribe of Benjamin near and its clans and the clans of the Matrites, and which was taken by lot. And the son of Kish was taken by lot. So it was narrowed down. Okay, Saul is the man. God reveals to them, Saul is the man. But when they sought them, they could not find him. And so they inquired again with her. So they asked the Lord, is there still another person to come? And the Lord said, behold, he has hidden himself among the baggage. He was hiding. He was fearful of perhaps that responsibility. He didn't want to fail or whatever. And so he hides himself. Ever hide yourself? Because feared failure, or you feared man. The thing that Saul didn't understand, or maybe he forgot, and sometimes that we forget when we're serving the Lord, is that it's not us that's serving, it's Christ serving through us. And he empowers us through the indwelling Holy Spirit to make a difference in this world. And we can, and this is my testimony. I sensed the calling of God, and I said, okay, God, I'll do anything. Just don't make me a pastor. There's no way I can do that. I feared failure. I wasn't taking on my own identity. of a child of God. And many times we hide ourselves, don't do what God wants us to do, because we don't take on that identity that Christ gives us, that we're more than conquerors in Him. That we're this new creation that He is making new, and that He will continue, that He is not finished, that He will finish what He has started in each one of us until the day of Jesus Christ. So fear led Saul to this spiritless work, and fear will take us to spiritless works. We've certainly seen it with this pandemic, where people have been in so fear they can't leave. They still can't leave their house. And so are fears keeping you from being faithful to Jesus, faithful to your church? Are your fears limiting your potential as a child of God? Galatians 6:8 says, "For the one who sows in his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption, but the one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life." Man, many times we reap what we sow because we're sowing it in our own strength, not trusting in the Spirit to do it through us. Are your fears causing you to sow in the flesh? Sometimes we reap corruption because we have sown corruption. Jesus tells us in John 15, He says that we can do nothing apart from Him. We are powerless to change anything in our lives apart from the work of the Spirit of God within us. That's why everyone that's in Regen is constantly in the Word and praying for one another, confessing our sins to one another and praying for one another so that we may be healed. Because the prayer of the righteous accomplishes much. So Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22 and 24, it says, "To put off the old, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds." You can't do anything apart from Christ. And the stuff that we sow in the flesh will be reaped in fleshly things. But if we allow the Spirit of God to work, it says, "Put on the new self," verse 24, "created after the likeness of God in the righteousness and in true righteousness and holiness." So there's nothing to fear. Nothing to fear. Goes on here in 1 Samuel chapter 13, Samuel said to Saul, "You have done foolishly. You have not kept the commands of the Lord your God with which we commanded you, for then the Lord would have established your kingdom over Israel forever, but now your kingdom shall not continue. The Lord has sought out a man after his own heart, and the Lord has commanded him to be prince over his people because you have not kept what the Lord commanded you." So we see that he would reign for several more years, but he would never reach the potential that God would have for him. And then eventually be replaced by David, who would be the first king that did right in the eyes of the Lord. So are we corporately squandering our potential? Are we individually squandering our potential? So as we close this message, we need to ask ourselves these questions. We need to ask our questions and be real about our fears, be real about our insecurities, to be real about the other hang-ups that we have not dealt with, that we need to deal with, that are hurting our potential for the Lord. It didn't work out for Saul. We know the story. It can work out for you. It can work out for us as we live faithfully in this time. Do you need to officially join this church? I'm telling you, for the greatest potential for this church and for you individually, God has called you to be a member of a church that's on the move, on mission for Christ. Have you officially joined? Is God speaking to you about that? How about baptism? Do you need to follow the Lord in baptism? Have you been unfaithful and not been baptized? You've accepted Christ in a service, maybe online, but you have not followed him in baptism. Follow him in baptism, man. We'll be baptizing in the near future. You can sign up online. There's a link on our website. Click baptism, sign up for it, and the next time we baptize, we'll make sure that you're ready. So many other ways that we can squander our potential through our unfaithfulness, giving. Talked about that earlier. Giving. Are you tithing? Are you giving to missions, to our partner missionaries? Are you being generous? Are you serving the Lord? What is it? What area of unfaithfulness is causing you to squander your potential? Man, how great our God is! Unbelievable. First step in towards faithfulness for every single human being is first trusting in Christ. Like David trusted me to poke holes in a bag full of water that he would not get wet. You too have to trust that Jesus Christ is the only way to salvation, that what he did on the cross by shedding his blood and dying was the sacrifice for your sin debt, because we've all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We all have wages. Our wages of sin has led us to death, but the gift of God is Jesus Christ. Have you trusted him? The first step to living up to the potential that God has within us is trusting Jesus Christ. Do you need to trust him this morning? Don't be embarrassed that maybe you've been coming here for a couple weeks, months, years. God's putting on your heart right now that you need to be saved. Don't be shy about that. Don't be embarrassed. Oh, there's no shame in admitting. Every one of us that is a child of God had to start with this step of obedience and trusting Christ. Trust him today. Don't wait till tomorrow. Not trying to scare anybody, but we're not guaranteed another opportunity like this, whether you're online or here in person, to receive Christ. So don't wait. You're ready. You're ready. You understand that your sin has caused a separation between you and a holy God, and that there is only one way to get rid of that sin, to remove that barrier between you and God, and that is belief. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. Only belief in what Jesus did for us on the cross will remove that barrier. If you're ready for that, I encourage you to accept him. I can lead you in a prayer, but it's not this mystical, magical prayer. It's basically you transferring your trust. What have you been trusting in to be right with God? Maybe nothing. Now you have something to believe in. Now you have something to trust in, and it's Jesus Christ. Trust in him today. Call upon his name. The Bible says if we call upon the name of the Lord, he will save us. Be saved today. Trust him today. Pray and receive him. Say, dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner, and I can't save myself, but I believe that Jesus died on the cross and paid the penalty for my sin, and I transfer all my trust to Him and Him alone. And I believe that He rose from the dead on the third day, and that He has raised me up to live out full potential as a child of God. And I want to live for Him. Amen. Man, I just sense that God has just done some pretty amazing stuff in some hearts. And I hope that you'll let us know the decision you've made to follow Christ this morning. And so you can do that. We have a text and church number. This is the number, 908-529-8500. Just type the word decision in there. Text that to us. It'll let us know that you've prayed and received Christ. You can do that. You're online. You can do that in person. Text us. Let us know. Hey, man, you're convicted that the Lord wants you to join this church. Text decision. We'll have a conversation. And then if you need to be baptized, text decision. You made a decision. You need to be baptized. God is working on your heart. Text that decision to that number. Let us know. It's just one step at a time. One step at a time by faith towards faithfulness that God does an amazing work.